So I'll just share that file first. So we were discussing on this types and details of hydrogenerators, and we'll finish off this section today. So we discussed about these three basic types last class, or the umbrella type, semi-umbrella type, and standard type generators. And then we looked at this detailed diagram of standard generator components for a standard type generator. And okay, so this all we discussed. Then we discussed few things on the stator, regarding the stator, and also we discussed. This we did, and we discussed regarding the shaft also. So we'll move ahead, and a few more components. As you can see, there are a lot of components in this particular diagram, but we'll basically discuss some of the prominent ones. So the stator and the rotor we have discussed, regarding the shaft we have discussed. So regarding the thrust bearing, the brakes, the cooling system, and the fire protection system, a few things we'll discuss today. So let's start with the brakes. So hydrogenerators are provided with a mechanical friction braking system. This system helps stop the generator's rotation after the unit is tripped offline. Okay, so there is mechanical braking system based on friction, as you can see here in the diagram number 15 and 16. Your number 15 is the brake pad and 16 is the brake ring, and so when it's required, this can be actuated, and they can bring the motion of the generator to a halt. So mechanical friction brakes usually are applied when the unit rotation has slowed down to less than 25% of the operating speed. So usually that is when they are applied, and as we'll see, it is actually the usually considered as the secondary braking mechanism. The primary braking mechanism is usually your the electrical braking or the dynamic braking, and mechanical brakes, they are used as a secondary measure, and only when the speed has slowed down to below 25%, then these brakes are applied. And what might be the reason for this? Can someone say why we want to use these mechanical brakes at low speed only, not at very high speed?
Sir, this is Harshvardhan.
Yes, sir. Sir.
Sir, if we use the mechanical friction brakes at a very high speed, then sir, there will be more heat will be dissipated, and which will also take away some material of our system.
Right. So yeah, primarily to prevent the wear and tear of the system, this is avoided. So even when we apply at low speed also, then also there is some wear and tear. So we always want to minimize that as much as possible. So mechanical friction brakes also are applied when the unit is at rest to maintain the unit at standstill. So, you know, like you have when in your car also, you have that handbrake. When the car is at standstill, then also you put that brake so that, you know, inadvertently there is no motion. So same way here also, when the unit is at rest, then also we put these brakes on to keep it at rest. Additional restraining force of the mechanical brakes is required, especially for Francis and Kaplan type turbines, if a significant amount of leakage water passes through the closed wicket gates. You know, because those, as we looked at in the last class, those wicket gates are there, which can be, you know, rotated, and they can be moved to allow the flow of water or restricted. So usually for these Francis and Kaplan turbines, those wicket gates, with passage of time, there is some leakage water which might be coming there. And as it says here, water leakage may become a problem after a number of years of unit operation, because the seals on the wicket gates become worn out. So due to that, there might be some leakage. So if you don't apply the brakes in the standstill, then the leakage water continuously flowing through the wicket gates causes the turbine and generator to rotate at a slow speed, which is also commonly known as creep. So that is the technical term, creep. So if this term, you come across creep of hydrogenerator, then basically it refers to this slow motion of the generator rotor due to the leakage of water through the wicket gates of Francis and Kaplan type turbines. And that might damage the thrust bearing. We'll look at it, because this thrust bearing usually if the machine is rotating at a very slow speed, then there might be a problem with the thrust bearing. So modern hydroelectric generators use electrical dynamic braking in addition to the mechanical friction braking system, as I said earlier. The electrical dynamic braking system minimizes the wear on the mechanical brake ring and brake pads. So that is the reason, because if the machine is rotating at a fast speed and you just forcibly try to stop it with mechanical braking system based on friction, it will lead to a lot of wear and tear in the moving parts. So to minimize that, typically the electrical dynamic braking system is taken as the primary system. The mechanical system is the braking system is a secondary one. So it prolongs the life of the moving parts. In addition, electrical dynamic braking reduces the duration over which the mechanical brakes are applied during a unit stop sequence, thereby minimizing the amount of brake dust produced by the mechanical brake system. So this is also one thing. I mean, whenever there is this braking which is applied and there is some wear, so there is something known as the brake dust which is produced to wear one of the moving parts. So that is also minimized by use of electrical braking. The extended life and reduced brake dust are especially significant for units that are started and stopped several times a day, or units such as those connected to Pelton turbines that operate at very high RPMs. So this effect of the reducing the brake dust and thereby increasing the life of the machine is very significant for these two types of machines. One are those which are started or stopped very frequently, and second one, especially those connected to Pelton turbines, because they have very high RPMs. So these two especially have a very big necessity for this. But overall also, the modern day machines, they actually come with this electrical dynamic braking system. And how this electrical dynamic braking functions is that electrical dynamic braking is initiated at a higher unit rotational speed, normally 50% of the rated speed. So as you can see, this is at a much higher speed. Mechanical braking is coming into picture only when the speed is below 25% of the rated speed, whereas electrical dynamic braking is usually applied point of 50% of the rated speed, and it is maintained until the mechanical friction brakes are applied. So from 50%, as you are slowing down the machine, you are bringing it down to standstill, so gradually cutting down the speed, and from 50% to 25%, these brakes will be applied, and then after that the mechanical brakes will take in. When dynamic braking is utilized in conjunction with the mechanical brakes normally are applied at 10 to 15% of the rated speed. So if you are using electrical dynamic braking, then you can even cut down the mechanical braking speed cutoff limit even lower. So then you further cut down on the wear and tear of the machine. So that way you apply these electrical brakes at around 50%, and then gradually as the machine speed comes down and it's around 15 or 10% of the rated, then actually you apply mechanical braking. So modern hydroelectric generators, especially pumped storage units, also utilize a brake dust vacuum system to capture most of the brake dust produced when the mechanical friction brakes are applied. So because that brake dust which might be produced due to that wear of the machine on application of the brakes, so to suck that out, some sort of vacuum system also is accompanied for modern machines, so as to do that particular thing. So this is one thing. And regarding electrical dynamic braking, I will share one paper with you. Let me just share it. So this is one paper which, it's a simple one, not really very complicated, but the good thing is that it presents the concepts in a very neat manner. So this is a paper on demonstration of a dynamic braking system for reduced runaway speed of hydraulic turbines. So you can have a look at this paper. I'll be uploading this in Microsoft Teams today. And this is just the overall schematic of the system and how this thing is applied. The distributed load is there. So this I'll be giving as an assignment actually, and this some simulation and all they have done. So you can go through this and So then finally they presented the results in terms of how much is the improvement with your this electrical dynamic braking system, and they found that the overspeed has been cut down by around 25% or so with using this dynamic load type braking system. So I'll share this paper, just showing it to you right now. I'll be sharing this on Microsoft Teams, and that will be an assignment. So just go through the paper, read the paper, and write a small summary. Let's say one or two page summary. Everyone is supposed to write a two-pager summary on what they understood from there, and what is this, how this dynamic braking system works, and you know, some significant things related to that from the paper. So, and this time I think I'll be uploading this assignment in Microsoft Teams only. So you can, again, same way, just write it down in your own words, and then you can upload it in Microsoft Teams itself in the assignments tab. And please, because this is a theoretical assignment, there is no numerical in this, you have to write it. So I expect everyone to write their own things in their own words. And if there is a plagiarism, and that means if two people are found to be copying each other's works, or they are copying from the paper, then that would be penalized. So ideal is that you just read the paper, close it, keep it separate, and then write in your own words what you understood. Or at least do that for, you know, what are the main sections, just read those sections. First you can read the entire thing.
Before sir?
That, just a minute, let me complete. So, another way you can do is that just read through the entire paper, and then you will get an idea, a sense of what is being talked about, and then just read the relevant sections where you can draw your things from. And once you have read it the second time, the relevant sections, keep the paper aside and then write in your own words. So that's the best thing to do. Okay, yes, Harshvardhan.
Sir, can we type it, or we should have to write it by ourselves?
Well, I mean, I'm okay both ways, but when you type it, then okay, I mean, I'm okay, no issue with that thing, you can do that, but then the diagrams and all, I don't know, you can make it on your own. I mean, it's okay if you want to make the diagram also, you can use Paint or some other software, drawing software for making the diagram, because when you're summarizing, probably you'll need to put at least a schematic diagram or something, you know, if you want to do it.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir.
Okay, so yeah, so you can do it that way and then submit it to me. I will upload, and one more assignment I'll be giving. So there'll be two assignments more. One will be just this paper, reading through this paper and summarizing in your own words. That will be one. And second assignment, I mean, that is not assignment as such, like you don't have to do any task, you just have to copy, but still I'm giving this because so that you are thorough with the components. So this diagram looks a little bit complicated and, you know, might be difficult to understand many times, but if you draw it on your own, then probably things will be more clearer and, you know, better understanding will also be there for you. So this is a straightforward assignment, nothing much to be done in this, but everyone please, now this you need to do by your own hand, so draw this thing and see what are the parts where they're located. So this will help you visualize the thing in it, get an insight in a better manner. So this is straightforward. This is just something to do by your own hands and get a hold of the thing.
Excuse me, sir?
Yes, Nitish.
Sir, it can be typed also, and it can be like handwritten also, na? The first one assignment, or it has to be now typed only?
Let's take one standard, I think, what everyone suggests. I mean, like Harshvardhan was saying for typing, I mean, is everyone okay for typing or handwritten?
Sir,
actually, if we will type, then sir, it'll also increase our typing speed on the computer. So that's
how many? Okay. Let me take it this way. How many people would want it typed? Just say one by one. How many people are for typing?
Anvesh
and Prashant. Prashant, two. Ah, you can raise your hands. That is good, no? Yeah, you can do that. Just raise your hand, you know. Just you can click on this. So how many people for typing? Just raise your hands. Only 4 people? What about all others? Okay, 5. Everyone else wants it handwritten. Is it like that?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. The diagrams will be problematic in
typing. Yes, Pranit?
Sir, the diagram will be problematic if you type.
Okay. So let's... Okay, few people are for typing. Many of them just want it handwritten. Okay, I think... Okay, let's just do... I mean... let's take... okay, whatever you everyone prefers as per their own thing. It's okay. I mean... Okay, because... A few people are for typing and few are, so it's, I'm okay either way. So those who want to type, they can type and send. Those who want to write it through hand and send, I'm okay with that.
Okay, sir.
But only criteria is that it has to be in your own words. So either you're typing or you're writing. Plagiarism is something which would be penalized. Okay, so I'll upload these two assignments also in Teams today. And submission will be through Teams only for these two.
Okay, sir.
Okay, so this was about the braking system. And as we saw, electrical braking is the primary one for modern machines. And only at a very slow speed, the mechanical brakes are applied. And another application of the mechanical brakes is that when the machine is at standstill, you want to prevent the creep occurring due to the leakage of water. So the mechanical brakes will keep kept applied. Now let's come to the next one, the thrust bearing. So as we discussed, this is a very important component for the machine. And you know, like the standard type generator has at the top and a smaller at the bottom also. The bottom guide bearing and the top mounted thrust and guide bearing. Whereas for other machines, it is the other way around. But either way, any of these machines, rotating machines, they need this thrust bearing to sustain the weight of the rotating parts. So as it says here, the thrust bearings absorb axial loads from rotating shafts into the stationary housings or mounts in which they are turning. Axial loads are those transmitted linearly along the shaft. So very clearly mentioned, so you have the shaft which is rotating, and so there will be this axial load along the shaft. So because this turbine is rotating at the bottom, and there is a water thrust, there is water which is a force of water which is hitting on the turbine blades and it's rotating. So as we understand, there is always, you know, equal and opposite reaction. So there will be some thrust which this machine will also experience along its axis. So this thrust bearing, it helps absorb that axial thrust and distributes it in the housing or the stationary components of the machine, so as to, you know, dissipate that particular thrust. So hydro generators, as we have discussed earlier, also, they have thrust bearings located either at the top for the standard type or bottom for the semi-umbrella or umbrella type. And also we discussed semi-umbrella will have a smaller bearing at the top, but the main one will be at the bottom. And in umbrella type, only at the bottom. So of the generator to support the rotating weight of the machine. So this thrust bearing, along with this thrust bearing, there is something known as this high pressure oil lift system, which also is there. So you will see most of the machines, hydro generator plants in India, if you visit, you will see there is this pressure system which is accompanying the generator. So that high pressure oil lift system, in short we call it as HPOL, that is provided for the thrust bearing, and it injects oil into each shoe pad of the bearing during starting and stopping of the unit. This helps establish a hydrodynamic oil film between the rotating and stationary members of the thrust bearing. So as we understand, but because this thrust bearing, there is a rotating member, the thrust collar, which is rotating, and the stationary one is the bearing shoe or the pad. So between the two, if you don't provide any lubrication, like through the oil, then there will be a lot of friction and it can damage the machine actually. So this, to maintain that lubrication, this type of high pressure oil lift system is provided with the machine, and it injects oil into the shoe pad and forms a film between the rotating and the stationary parts. So the presence of the hydrodynamic oil film minimizes bearing wear, Consequently, during a unit start, the HPOL is turned on before the unit starts to rotate. So first of all, for the start sequence, before the unit starts to rotate, the HPOL system has to be turned on, and so that the lubrication is already there. And then gradually, as you open the wicket gates and the turbine catches speed, the generator also catches, the shaft catches speed. So, and you know, the speed builds up, and once the unit speed reaches up to around 75% to 90% of the rated speed, then one can shut off the HPOL unit. And the reason is that because at the higher rotational speeds, this hydrodynamic oil film is self-sustaining. You don't need to pump, inject more oil. It just sustains at the higher speeds. And so this HPOL will be turned on before the machine starts, and then it will be on, it will keep injecting oil till this particular point at 75% to 90% of the rated speed. And once that speed is reached, then this oil injection system can be closed, shut off, and then the machine continues its operation. This hydrodynamic oil film sustains itself. And once you want to shut down the machine again, see, the HPOL is turned on when the unit speed decreases to 75% to 90% range. You around that range, you put it on the HPOL, and it is turned on, and it is maintained until the unit is at standstill. So right through the stopping sequence, this HPOL is on, and as it says here, the maximum wear on the bearing pads occurs at the slow speeds when, due to hydrodynamic effects, the oil film no longer is maintained over the entire bearing surface. So that is the most critical time when the rotational speed of the machine is very low. Then that due to this hydrodynamic effects, the oil film is not uniform, and that can cause a lot of friction and damage to the machine. That's why, as you can understand, we mentioned earlier when we were discussing about the brakes, is that that's creep is a very important phenomenon, because due to that leakage or creep, the generator might rotate at a slow speed, but this might have a big damage on the thrust bearing. So we want to prevent that creep that type of damage from occurring to the machine. Another alternative also sometimes people use is proposed is that instead of this HPOL system to prevent this type of friction and damage to the thrust bearings, there is an option of coating the bearing pads with PTFE, the polytetrafluoroethylene type of material. But this is not so popular in India. So these PTFE bearing designs, commonly used in Russia, China, and some of the European countries, but not so popular in India. In India, you usually see that this oil pressure system, HPOL system, high pressure oil lift system, is provided along with the each generating unit. Then next is the coolers. So as we discussed last time also, and we've been discussing throughout, that the heating of the windings, both the rotor and the stator windings, that presents a very stringent limit on how much power you can draw from the machine. And that is actually the limiting criteria. So these coolers are a very critical and important component of the machine to cool down the windings. So usually water to air coolers are normally provided because it's a hydropower plant, so water is amply available, and this water can be circulated through these heat exchangers, which transfers the heat from the inner parts of the winding to the outside air. And these are provided for all modern hydro generators rated greater than 5 MVA. So usually any generator 5 MVA or above will have this water to air cooler. The coolers are situated around the outside periphery of the stator core. So as we discussed and looked at this diagram also, this number 18 here, air heat exchangers. So those will be provided across the outer periphery of the machine, of the stator. So the coolers are situated around the outside periphery of the stator core. Generators equipped with water to air coolers can be designed with smaller physical dimensions, reducing the cost of the generator. So that becomes obvious, because because if you don't have a cooler, then basically you want to increase the surface area over which the winding is laid out, so that there is more heat dissipation. But if you have this type of a water to air cooler system, then you can cut down on that surface area needed for heat dissipation. So the design can be more efficient, it can have a more smaller physical dimension, reducing the cost of the generator. automatic regulation of the cooling water flow in direct relation to the generator loading results in more uniform machine operating temperatures, increasing the insulation life of the stator windings. So this type of thing might be a better option, is that the water flow, which is the rate of water flow flowing in the heat exchangers for cooling, that can be connected to the generator loading. So, you know, as the generator loading increases, then the rate of water flow also increases, so the amount of heat dissipation is also faster. So that way, if one has that type of automatic regulation between the water flow rate through these coolers and the generator loading, then that machine operation is more efficient, the winding temperatures are more uniform, and the insulation life is better. So normally generators should be furnished with one more cooler than the number required for operation at rated MVA. This allows one cooler to be removed for maintenance without affecting the unit output. So because this is a very critical component of the machine, as you can understand, because the entire machine, everything else is okay, but this is the limiting factor, the heating of the windings. So we cannot really compromise on this heating of the windings, and that's why it's suggested that usually you should have a spare cooler more than what is needed, so that, you know, if one thing needs to be taken out for maintenance, then also the machine can operate. So that is the cooler. The generator cooler, this is obvious because we are talking about a hydropower plant. So this water which needs to be circulated through the these heat exchangers for cooling, that can be supplied either from the penstock. So penstock, as we understand, is the pipe which is bringing the water and to the turbine, from the four-way tank to the turbine. So either you can draw it from the penstock via a pressure reducing station, because in the penstock there is a very high pressure of water, so you bring it through a pressure reducing station, or it can also be pumped from the tail race. So tail race is the final part, I mean, after the water has rotated the turbine, the water which falls from the turbine, it goes through a particular duct, it goes back to the river. So that is the tail race. So either it can be taken from the penstock to the cooling system, or it can be pumped upwards from the tail race back to the cooling system, either way. But in either case, as it says here, automatic self-cleaning filters must be provided in the cooling water supply lines to avoid frequent fouling or plugging of the water to your coolers. So that is, I mean, obvious, as you can understand, because these cooling devices, the heat exchangers, they'll have the fins which will have very thin cross-sectional area for the water to flow. So we cannot really tolerate any type of particles in that particular water which is being supplied to the cooler. So even for the turbine, we say that for turbine you need to remove all the sediments and everything, because if the sediments are there, they'll like corrode the turbine. So even despite that, so even you have removed significant amount of sediments, but still before supplying to the water cooling system, this water needs to be passed through a self-cleaning filter. So this has to be completely filtered and clean water, so as to avoid the clogging of the water to air coolers. So that is the cooler. And then finally, the fire extinguishing system. And this also relates to, so the cooler is also related to the heating of the windings, and this fire extinguishing system, I mean, otherwise also any fire can break out due to other reasons also, but yeah, here you have a winding which is getting heated, and if there is an overload, there might be a fire which might be there, or even there is a short circuit or something in the winding, then also the fire might be there. So this also is very critical, as you understand, for safe operation of the system. So as the generator MVA size increases, I mean, there has to be justification for putting the fire extinguishing system. So here the cost justification is given. As the generator MVA size increases, the initial cost of the fire protection system becomes minimal in relation to the lost generation and repair cost. So as we can understand, because this is one extra investment which we are making in terms of the fire extinguishing system. So the capital cost might be there for this thing, but if you look at it over the lifetime of the generator, due to the fire extinguishing system being there, you can cut down on many of, you know, big damages to the generator. So the amount of generation which one will lose due to the problems, due to damage in the generator, or the cost which will go into the repair of the generator, if you total it up for the entire lifetime of the generator, that is much higher as compared to the capital cost for putting the fire extinguishing system. So therefore, especially for all hydroelectric generators greater than 25 MVA, they have to be furnished with one of the fire extinguishing systems, either based on a water deluge system or a carbon dioxide fire extinguishing system, to minimize the damage caused by a fire inside the machine. Now, some historical facts are given here since the
Sir?
Yeah.
This is Harshvardhan, sir. Sir, what is water deluge system, sir?
Either you can cut down the fire either through spraying water over it or through CO2. Okay. So, water deluge will use the water taken from either the penstock or the tail race to cut down, I mean, to cut the supply of oxygen to the fire.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. So, since the late 1970s, generators have been manufactured with self-extinguishing insulation. That is, I mean, the insulation usually is designed that way, that fire or any particular hazard which occurs can be extinguished out. So with this type of insulation, a fire is extinguished once the short circuit or other heat source that initiated the fire is removed. However, in many instances, short circuit current will continue to occur inside the generator until it stops rotating. So if you have this type of self-extinguishing insulation, if you remove the short circuit or the cause which is causing that particular fire, then the winding, the insulation will cause the fire to be extinguished. But as you understand, in many instances, the short circuit current will continue to occur until the generator has completely stopped rotating. So this thing becomes very critical, and that's why it says here, earlier generator insulation systems were not self-extinguishing. That was before few decades back, but usually now they will come with this type of self-extinguishing feature. A fire protection system for generators less than 25 MVA usually is not justified on a cost basis if the generator manufacturer certifies that the insulation system is self-extinguishing. So for smaller generators, usually less than up to 25 MVA, the self-extinguishing insulation, if it is provided for the winding, that is sufficient. But for larger generators, that won't be sufficient. So in this case also, when you are talking about the smaller generators less than 25 MVA, the generator manufacturer has to certify that the insulation system is self-extinguishing. In that case, probably one can avoid putting the fire extinguishing system separately, but otherwise this is needed. However, oil reservoirs or bearing lubrication system should be investigated thoroughly to ensure that they are not capable of sustaining a fire. Because as we discussed above, that HPOL, that high pressure oil lift system, which is providing the lubricating oil to the thrust bearings, that can be another source, because oil, as we understand, might be a possible inflammable material. So this needs to be also ensured that this should not be capable of sustaining a fire. In the absence of any international standards concerning generator fire protection systems, a wide variety of systems have been deployed throughout the world. So depending upon which type of what type of material they are using for cutting down the fire. So usually, as we said, there are two types. One is using CO2 for cutting down the supply of oxygen to the fire, or another one using water. So the commonly preferred fire extinguishing agent in United States is CO2. Other countries, including Canada, Japan, and Russia, commonly utilize water deluge systems. India also, you'll find most of the generators, they will use this water deluge systems, using water for cutting down the fire. Both types of systems have advantages and disadvantages, and the preference is usually based upon tradition, government regulations, and insurance requirements. So that is it about these components of the hydro generator and the practical details of it. And so we will stop here because the next chapter, I mean, is something different to start. So we have 10-15 minutes. Any discussion, any questions you have, anyone is having?
Sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, by what date we'll have to submit the assignment, sir?
Yeah, I will put that up. So today is 15th. So let's say what I will propose is this, the smaller one, the figure which is to be made, that this figure or the components. So please understand, I mean, the logic behind this, there is nothing input needed from your side, but this is just to make things more clearer for you. Once you do it by your own hand, you will be more, it will be, you know, settling down in your brain. So for this, I think you can, I'll set up a date of, let's say, Friday. I'll be uploading now. So you can have 2 days. So before Friday's class, hopefully. So in next 2 days, Wednesday and Thursday, you'll get 2 days for submitting this. And the other one, where you have to read the paper and prepare a summary and submit it, that I will put the deadline by Sunday, let's say. Yeah, so you'll get around 3, 4, 5 days. And okay, Monday, sir, tutorial, okay. Yeah, and Monday, the tutorial class on 21st, in that class, we will discuss that paper and the summary which you all will provide. Based on that, we'll do a discussion.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. Any other questions?
So the second chapter is also over now, sir?
Yeah, so I mean, chapter wise, if you look at it, you can say we are just dealing with different sections as such per se. So this is the third section here. First was some basic idea about synchronous generators. Then we did the analytical equations in detail. And this is the third section. So I'll upload, by the way, I'll upload these notes also. So this is
okay,
the third section, actually.
Mm-hmm. Okay, sir. Okay.
Next, the fourth one will be the testing of synchronous generators. So before commissioning a particular hydropower plant, there are some tests which need to be performed. So we will look at those also in the next class.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Anyone else? Any other questions or inputs? Okay, so in that case, I think this is okay. So I'll be uploading. Please go through the assignments in your MS Teams and upload there itself. And then we'll discuss further on Thursday.
Sure, sir.
Okay,
so we'll stop here.
Okay, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.